Hello everyone, I am Deb Schur, Artistic Director of Avaloch Farm Music Institute, and I am absolutely delighted to welcome you to Made at Avaloch, our new series created to celebrate the variety and excellence of the work Avaloch has supported. Each event will highlight one or two projects and will include discussions with musicians about process, as well as recorded performances of completed work. So far, Avaloch has hosted over 1,000 musicians in hundreds of groups and including dozens of composers. We hope you enjoy the diversity and depth of the genre and approaches to the creative process which will be presented here. Before we begin, however, I would like to thank a few people. First, our administrative team, Mason Donovan and Jenna Hall. Second, our musical team, Hannah Collins, Mike Compitello, Catherine Dowling, who joined me in creating these events. And last, but certainly not least, Fred Tauber, without whose generosity, the vision and inspiration of Avaloch would never have come to be. So, thank you for joining us for this ongoing celebration of creative work made at Avaloch.
Welcome, everyone. Thank you for joining us for Made at Avaloch this evening. My name is Hannah Collins, and I'll be your host. And tonight, we are joined by the three members of the Merz Trio, pianist Lee Dionne, violinist Brigid Coleridge, and cellist Julia Yang. Hello, everyone. Thanks for being here.
Hey, Hannah. So,
hi. Love seeing you. This evening is going to be really special. We're going to talk about a particular program, and I'd love to just right away ask you, Julia, what are we about to experience? What is this project?
So tonight we wanted to share with you our Those Secret Eyes, which is a multidisciplinary recital theater piece that we created in 2018. And Avaloch was a huge part in putting this together, in really really putting the concept into place and programming it. And well, Bridge will talk a bit more about how we came up with the scripts. And it involves a dancer, Caroline Copeland. It revolves around Brahms' C minor trio, and it's inspired by Shakespeare's Macbeth. In fact, actually, to give you a more vivid picture, it's imagining Lady Macbeth in her evening wanderings around her deserted castle. And of course, you might know the scene where she's trying to wash her hands of the blood of slain King Duncan, and she's guilt-ridden, et cetera. But this is really the only picture that we have of those night wanderings, but we know that that she's doing this every evening. And so our piece actually imagines, what else is she doing these evenings? What else is she thinking of? Who is she as a human? And that's what this piece is about.
Amazing, like what a crazy world to enter into the mind of Lady Macbeth. And you mentioned, you know, that there's a movement element to this, there's lighting, there's, you know, a full theatrical side. So, you know, for those of you who are not familiar with this trio, they're incredibly accomplished, have, you know, won the last year's Concert Artist Guild competition, have won the Fischoff competition, you know, have made beautiful videos and recordings. So you've all been playing together for a long time. And sort of how does this project fit into your story as a trio? Is it something you had always dreamed of doing? Is it something that came up after playing together for quite a long time? Maybe Bridget, we can start with you.
Yeah, it was something that we talked about very early on, actually. Not this specific project, but rather the idea that this fits into, which was alongside our commitment to playing recitals, which is an activity that we really enjoy, we were really interested in bringing in the other interests that we have outside of playing music, outside of being a trio. And this was something that we ourselves and collectively understood to be always a part of any rehearsal process. Our outside interests aren't left at the door. They come in and they inform how we think about the music, how we communicate with one another, the kinds of metaphors and similes we might draw upon to really articulate what we're thinking about the music as we work through it together. And it seemed an honest expression of ourselves to find ways that we could share these other interests more overtly with our audiences. And so we worked on this project really starting from a musical point of view. Lee actually came in with the idea and said he had been listening to a range of music and it had been reminding him of certain plot points in Macbeth. And Julia and I thought, oh, that's an intriguing idea. We don't necessarily hear those pieces that way, but let's see if we can think ourselves into Lee's imagination and try and find some common ground here. And it was really intriguing and a very fruitful experience. My inclination with these kinds of projects is always to start from the text, which is a slightly different thing from Lee, perhaps, in this instance. And so that's where I went immediately. And one thing that intrigued me and intrigued us all really was Lady Macbeth is such a, she's such an evocative, powerful figure in the imagination when you think about Macbeth, when you read through Macbeth, or when you experience it as a play. But really, as a character, she has so few lines in the play as a whole. And that was something really fascinating to us, that this woman could hold such a sway on the imaginations of an audience, but also really dictate the way a drama moved. She really is the force that propels all of the movement in the play forwards. And that was a very tantalizing prospect. So I started to think about the ways in which the other voices in the play, the other characters, could perhaps be understood to voicing certain imagined feelings of Lady Macbeth. And so we ended up with a wall at Avaloch that was covered in cut out bits of text from, we went through the entire play individually and pulled out lines that spoke to us and then covered a whole wall. It was very messy. And then stood back and tried to see something very, very idealistically.
What you're describing to me sounds like one of those scenes from a detective story where people are trying to piece together the mystery of what happened.
Yeah, totally. Trying to find some sort of thread through things.
Amazing. So Lee, Bridget mentioned, you know, that maybe the very spark of this kind of came from you, the initial idea. And we'll talk more later about how the project is developing, but just at the very outset, you know, at Avaloch, when you were working together, how did it change? How did it, yeah, how, what was your experience of how far it moved from your initial thought?
Yeah, it's kind of with hindsight now, I feel like, now that we've worked on a few other projects together, that I'm starting to understand better too, how we all work together and come at these things. For me, like Bridge was saying, it always really starts with the music, and I often just try to imagine some kind of like programming mixtape in my head of like things I would want to hear next to each other, or like connections that I think would be really cool. And so of course there's always like some research and stuff, but I feel like my personal style is always a little bit more like throwing spaghetti at the walls and just seeing what sticks, and then like Bridget comes in or Julia will like do some research and actually be thoughtful about it, and they'll be like, oh, like what if we actually like thought about this and like did this and that. And so when we got to Avaloch, I already had a number of like musical pieces in mind that I thought would work well with the Brahms, so that we could interweave. But actually, I mean, a lot of the initial idea from the Brahms actually had just come from like random thesis research a long time ago, when I was reading about Brahms and Schumann and them being like obsessed with Scotland and like this chivalric style in their music, and then like the number of Scottish songs that they each composed, like, which is actually kind of staggering. And like some of them are not with opuses or anything like that, but they're just kind of everywhere. And there's this Scottish style that appears. And so I was like really hearing this in the C minor trio. But then as a result, we also brought a bunch of like song scores up to Avaloch just to read through and be like, oh, like would this one work? Would this one work? And most of it we threw out. But then on that wall, we had a lot of both like quotes from the text, and then also like different pieces, and they were all organized by theme around each other. So we had like 13 different themes, like time and night and women or like whatever, and you know, just orbiting ideas.
Amazing. So let's start to think about watching some clips from this show. We talk about it so much, everyone will want to see. I think the first clip is a section of Charlotte Bray's piece. And if you could introduce for us, you know, what happens in the show prior to this moment, and tell us a little bit about this piece. Julia, can I start with you?
Sure. Is that, yeah.
Please, yeah.
So we're about to watch Charlotte Bray's Those Secret Eyes, which is the piece from whose name we were inspired to name our own theater piece. And she wrote this piece in 2014, and it's a 5-minute piece or so inspired by the female characters in Macbeth. So of course, Lady Macbeth, the witches, Lady Macduff. And it's funny, the place that comes in the show, it comes very close to the beginning. It's not the very opening, because actually, we'll talk about this a little bit later, but we staged the show at the Kosciuszko Foundation in New York City. And we were going for the deserted castle vibe, you might say, that we were imagining the play. And so nobody who was coming to this show really knew what they were going to experience. And this was, of course, the first time that we were putting it on. And so it begins with the lights going dim and music playing in the background, not the three of us. It's from Verdi's Macbeth. It's from the aria, again, where Lady Macbeth is trying to wash off these spots off her hands. And we all enter in the dark to this music. And then what you're about to experience in this first clip is the first instance of both the text and the music and this interaction.
Great, let's have a listen. Couple of minutes from Charlotte Bray's piece, but already we can get a sense of what it's like. For those of you who haven't been to the Kosciuszko Foundation, it is one of these sort of old mansions on the east side, right? And when you enter, you do go up a sort of grand staircase into the room that we saw the performance in. So it isn't a big stretch to imagine being in some sort of castle there, especially with the mood lighting. So we're beginning to see, you know, your setup and the way the audience is so close to you and the way that they're listening to the music. And let's talk a little bit about how you incorporated text into the piece. So Brigid, how did you choose the text, and how is the audience experiencing the text during this performance?
When we were thinking about how to work with the text, in a sense, we were really working from, I suppose using a template of how we might interpret a score, for example. We were looking at this obviously very old, very well-known Shakespeare play, and really trying to bring some of our world and our reading of that text into our sense of how we might organize it and how we might have it speak to the music. It was very important to us that it didn't end up being an experience of you hear a piece of text read and then you hear some music that, you know, may or may not for an audience member correspond to the vague feeling that they perceive in the text. We didn't want either text or music to be illustrative of one another. We were really interested in what are the ways that we can facilitate dialogue that might lead to some unexpected places. And so the first thing that we did was we decided we're just going to use text from the play. But what we're going to do is we're going to shape this as a show that is just Lady Macbeth talking to herself. And I think I mentioned before that she has very few lines that she actually speaks in the play, and you don't get a lot of insight into her private thought. It's all very much the exterior. So this seemed very fruitful ground. And as we were reading through, we realized, gosh, a lot of the things that the other characters are saying, we could imagine those words being spoken as an interior monologue by Lady Macbeth, depicting the kinds of emotions that we read her potentially experiencing. And so then it became a process of breaking the lines of dialogue up and then piecing them back together in a kind of puzzle of our own making. And we decided that we would record these lines. They were roughly, in the end, broken up, I think, into about 10 sections worth of chunks that were really an interweaving of a myriad of voices from the play. So you would have a line that you might recognize that's spoken in the play by Macbeth, juxtaposed and moving seamlessly into a line that maybe Lady Macduff speaks right towards the end of the play. And then once we had those sections of text, it became a question of, well, how do we understand the relationship between these portions of text and the music that we've chosen? And what are the ways that we can emphasize this? So we used a number of techniques. Often it was just a juxtaposition of text and then music, but sometimes it was more active. For example, there are a number of moments where the music blends into the text, or vice versa, that the text bleeds into the beginning of a section. There are a number of moments where we pick up on rhythmic similarities. Obviously, when we're talking about Shakespeare, we're talking about an iambic pentameter, and so very specific rhythms. And as we'll see in a couple of other clips, some of those rhythms are found within some of the music that we're playing. So we really play with those ideas of rhythmic manipulation. And we also had some more sudden and shocking interruptions of text or music with one or the other, as we'll discuss a bit later.
That's so brilliant. I'm wondering, have you had any audience members who are completely familiar with the play comment on the way the lines were put together?
Yeah, a few people, although it does seem to be one of those plays that has really entered just, I guess, the English language imagination, that so many phrases really originated in that play. And of course, there are all of the famous lines. And I think, like with a lot of Shakespeare plays, people really remember and I definitely found it in my own reading that I was remembering the very well-worn lines, but then there were all of these other gems in there that I wouldn't be able to tell you off the top of my head who spoke them, but suddenly when you see them in a completely unfamiliar context, they speak with a certain eloquence, I think, that you don't necessarily find every time you're reading through the entire thing.
That's great. That's so much richness already, but there's another layer, which is Caroline Copeland, the dancer and sort of actor in this piece. And Caroline's work I'm familiar with from the perspective of her being an expert in Baroque dance and historical dance, and having seen her perform in costume, you know, in the style of 18th century and 17th century dance, but this is an entirely different type of approach to movement than I've seen her do before. So Lee, can you tell us a little bit about Caroline and just how she came into this project?
Yeah, actually, I mean, so Caroline was a previous collaborator for me as well, and I don't know her as well in her role as a Baroque dancer, but actually I know her from this show that we both were in, Hannah, many years ago with Cantata Profana. But actually what I remember most about her role in that show, even though she was fantastic throughout and she was dancing Poulenc as well, it wasn't just Baroque stuff, but I remember this very specific piece that you were playing with Arash, cello and theorbo, and Caroline was sitting there as a third, basically a third chamber partner. It was the three of them at the front of the stage. And Caroline was doing something incredibly simple, actually, just seated with, I think, one mask or two masks.
Yeah, I think it was just one mask.
It was just one mask, and she was just kind of bringing it up to her face and putting it back down. It was very reflective. And I just remember being so struck by the her repertoire of emotion that she was conveying through those simple gestures and the intimacy of the whole experience. So I think that's actually something that you'll see in the next clip that we're gonna show of the Schumann. I thought she was fantastic through the whole show in just being really so understated in a way with what she was doing gesturally, but also conveying so much expression and almost modeling a way of listening and connecting with the music, even as she was playing this role.
Great, let's watch that clip and we'll talk a little bit more about it when we come back. So this is a selection from Schumann's Six Studies in Canonical Form, right? And we'll talk a little bit more about that piece when we come back from this clip.
The time is free. Let us speak our hearts to each other. I have words that would be howls out in the desert air, where hearing should not latch them. Thank you.
That Schumann is just so beautiful, and I'm not familiar with it. Lee, could you explain a little bit more about what that piece is and the arrangement?
Yeah, so it's one of the six studies in canonic form, which is this very elaborate title for a set of pieces that Schumann wrote. One such piece that he or Mendelssohn or any number of those composers at the time who were really into Bach might have written, being inspired by the sorts of counterpoint and just canonic interaction they heard and were really obsessed with in this really nerdy way with Bach stuff. And I think what's really great about those pieces is they're so beautiful, but they're also so weird. And he wrote them for this instrument called the pedal piano, which is sort of like an organ in how you play it, but it's basically like a piano with extended extra bass notes available that you can play with your feet. So you're able to play a much bigger texture than normally on a piano. And so it's an instrument that was only relevant for about 40 years in the 19th century, and then nobody played it anymore. So there are actually a lot of arrangements of these pieces because they're really beautiful, but there's no way to play them. So they were arranged by Theodor Kirchner, who is a contemporary composer of the time and later friend of Brahms and Clara Schumann. Debussy also really liked those pieces. Just random piece of trivia.
You play it so beautifully. You know, of course, we hear this conversation between you, and if it hadn't been for the title, I wouldn't pay so much attention to how cleverly done it is.
Right.
Because just listening is such a, you know, enjoyable experience, and that just the communication feels so natural. But then the title makes you think, like, wow, that's actually, that imitation is very intellectually put together. So
right.
Nice.
And it's kind of a good segue in a way into like something that we're doing more of in general these days, which is just arranging, because the trio repertoire is big, but it's not as big as the quartet repertoire, for instance. And with arranging, it's funny too, because I feel like there's two really good reasons to arrange, and one is if the piece is just so amazing that everybody wants to play, like you want to play it for brass quintet, you want to play it for two pianos. And then the other reason is like if it's just a piece that's amazing but nobody knows, and you really want people to be able to hear it. And so this is definitely something inspiring in that category.
Well, it's beautiful. Thank you for sharing that. We're going to launch next into a sort of meatier clip, a longer chunk of this piece, which is starting to get quite exciting and introduce some different textures and a different atmosphere. So, Julia, do you want to lead us into what we're about to see?
Yeah, sure. So we're about to hear two miniatures by Johannes Maria Staud. So we're fast forwarding to music from Vienna. I believe he wrote this in 2009. And it's taking Lady Macbeth, for instance, into this bizarre psychology of much contrast to what you've heard already in the past. And it was actually interesting to talk to and work with Caroline in this whole process of creating the show, because none of us are dancers or actors in the sense that she is, with her particular experience. And in fact, as we were pitching this whole show idea to her, she almost wrote herself out of the play and was directing it in a sense of being like, what if you used projection and had an actor? And and we were like, no, we would like you to be in the part of the show. And we sort of had this vision of her, but in a sense it was somewhat vague, and she actually created every sort of interaction in a sense that she had with the music. And so this next clip demonstrates the different ways that she involves herself, some of the props actually that she chose to use in this particular Staud miniature number 5. You see her in her mind, and in the text before, there's this repetition. She's unraveling in a sense. And actually in a later production of this, Those Secret Eyes, show, she decided to go much further with this particular prop and completely get entangled and enmeshed. And it was incredible, because actually none of us were expecting this. And it's only during the show and afterwards we're realizing what this music is forcing within her, and how she's also interpreting it and what sorts of thoughts she's having.
Incredible. I know there's a kind of a special way that we enter into this sound piece, particularly with you, Lee. I think you begin the piece, is that right?
Yeah.
How does that entrance into, what should we be prepared for as we start to watch this?
So it actually, it begins with a very strange sound, just FYI, which is like an eraser between the bottom two strings of the piano. And it's also miniature four of a set of 10 miniatures by Staud that are all attacca. So it's a really incredible piece. It's about 14 minutes long, 10 miniatures. So each of them is really short. And we actually think it's just one of the most amazing things written for trio in like the last 20 years, but nobody just knows this piece. And there's such intensity and variety of character between the different movements. So we thought it was really great, and a great piece to also be able to break up and just showcase here and there.
Great. Let's listen to this next section of The Secret Eyes.
I have almost forgot the taste of fears. The time has been that when the brains were out, the man would die and there an end. Oh, full of scorpions is my mind, dear wife. There's no such thing. There's nothing serious in mortality. All is but toys. Thank you.
Okay, so we just cut off in the middle of some beautiful Brahms, but I promise we'll get back to it very shortly. We thought first we'd have a quick conversation just about this piece, this Opus 101 Brahms C minor piano trio, and how that became, you know, grew into this beautiful production. You know, what was it about that piece? What was it, how did you use that as the framework for this whole show? Brigid, we can start with you.
When we were first talking about that, the idea of this show, this was the piece that Lee was adamant that we were going to use. And I admit that initially I was thinking, really? I mean, I can't quite see the apparently very like clear connection between this and Macbeth. But as it went on, I mean, it's been so fascinating to experience how incorporating an entire trio like that into a show like this completely changes the way that you think about what is really a staple of the trio repertoire, or at least for us it is. And the C minor trio is, it's such a taut, tightly constructed work in a way. It's as if Brahms is utterly economical in the kinds of emotional gestures that he makes, the kind of emotions that he's conveying, but those emotions are so extreme. The first movement is constantly plunging from one state of a kind of manic driving forwards to, you know, like the most glorious melodies that are often shared between violin and cello, and then are handed to piano in this absolute expansion of sound and color. And the second movement is absolutely changed. It's a scherzo, but it's like a door has opened and a cold wind blows in and you feel absolutely destabilized in your listening. You don't know where you're being taken and the ground is always shifting beneath you. And then that movement morphs into one of the most beautiful third movements of any Brahms work, I think, where it's like a lullaby. It's absolutely stops you in your tracks as a listener. And then the fourth movement, it is absolutely taken up with the energy of the first movement in a sense. It has these constantly moving forward rhythms and is always prone to explosion in really unexpected and frankly slightly shocking ways. So what we decided to do with this movement was not be led by the form that was dictated by the music, which would be obviously, you know, you listen to the first movement, second movement, third movement, fourth movement. Rather, we thought about which parts of the text that we were using we wanted to have each movement in conversation with. And then that in the end led to actually beginning with the second movement. So in the course of the show, the audience hears the second movement of Brahms before they hear the fourth movement of Brahms, before they hear the third movement of Brahms, and then we end with the first movement. And that's just in terms of the Brahms listening. Of course, there are other pieces and other things that are going on between most of those movements. But that was a really fascinating experience for us, and we hope for the listener too, because it really drew attention to the very specific emotional world of each of those movements. I think that we can become accustomed to hearing an entire work, and we are very well schooled in our reactions and our sense of how each movement relates within that overall structure. And this was really an opportunity to treat the music almost as we were treating the text, to really say, well, this is something that we are working with, and we are going to feel that we are allowed to break this up in a way, or we are allowed to investigate this as a material to be used in this show.
That's amazing. I first thought is, when you play it in a concert, does it now feel completely out of order?
Yeah.
Well, that's next.
And definitely, like, we now associate certain moments in specific movements with like very specific dramatic moments in this show. So it's completely changed the way that we play this piece.
Well, we're about to see one of these dramatic moments, so we're going to dive back into the fourth movement and just see how the show progresses from there. So here comes this next clip.
Thank you.
Okay, so there were definitely some surprises there. Brigid, can you tell us a little bit about what just happened and how you all came to this decision? Because thus far, as I understand it, no one has spoken text directly to the audience
Right, exactly.
until you come along.
This came about. It's funny to think of it now, but we had decided fairly early on that we wanted to pre-record all of the text. In part because there was something nice about having Caroline as the physical embodiment of Lady Macbeth, and then just to have this voice that emerges from around the audience, as if Lady Macbeth is just part of the air that is around them. So she's just permeating everything. But there was something about these lines in particular, and the way that we understood the music relating to them, that really called for just. We wanted to convey the sense of shock that those words cause in the text and in the dramatic arc of the whole narrative. And one of the things that has always really interested us about this whole idea of creating these sorts of shows or really theatre pieces that involve a piano trio is trying to explore the ways that the piano trio, both as a physical form and in the way that we are as players, how that has so much potential for a kind of physical drama there. And yeah, I suppose the idea just came to us that it would be shocking if you were sitting in a show. Like I would be shocked if I had been lulled into a false sense of security that what I was watching was a piano trio playing for most of the show, and then suddenly the voice that I've been hearing just explodes from the center of the players. I mean, that would be completely destabilizing, both in terms of really challenging my preconception of what I was watching and what expectations I had brought into the room about the genre. So it really grew from an amalgamation of all of those ideas. But I have to say that in practice, I am always shocked when that happens. I mean, nothing, I don't think I will ever feel a level of comfort with ending Brahms 4, even though at the same time, there is a sense in which it does feel completely natural to just like finish that triumphantly in C major, you know, one of the great Brahms endings, you know, in the major key of a minor piece. And then just kind of like follow my bow upwards. So almost as if, you know, that real understanding of like your instrument is an extension of your body, that there you are. But yeah, it also presents a challenge, like making myself find a voice at that moment.
Well, there's a certain urgency that it feels like you have no choice. I mean, dramatically, but also maybe personally, there's just no choice. It has to happen now. But that urgency is so shocking. Did you have any sort of thespian, you know, background, or is this just
I mean, definitely, you know, in former parts of my life, like definitely at school, I really loved that. And for a time, that was what I was really interested in doing. But so it feels like a treat for me a little bit to dabble in this little interest.
Well, let's watch this next clip, which is going to begin with the first movement, part of the first movement of the Brahms, and then segue into something else. And let's see what it is, and we'll talk a little bit more when we come back.
Thank you.
Nothing in his life became him like the leaving of it. Yet, who would have thought the old man to have so much blood in him? Sarah, your father's dead. And what will you do now? How will you live? As birds do. Tears shall drown the wind.
So not only do you get to deliver some of the most dramatic lines, Brigid, you also sing so beautifully in this piece. Another moment that sort of has no warning. And I have, you know, I just have to ask where that came from. Is this something that Brigid, that you brought in, or something that was coaxed out of you, the idea for you to sing?
I mean, a bit of both. I suggested that song that we just heard, Eubanks and Brays, and then nobody else was willing to sing. It's not like I'm, you know, gagging to sing every show at all.
This is a very important principle of group decision making. the sort of not it, you know, method of deciding.
So that was, I mean, I have a bit of a folk music background, even though this is a Scottish song and my background is more in Irish folk music, but that seemed to me to fit this moment in particular, and it's this nice link because it is this Scottish song, and you know, we've been talking previously about Brahms and Beethoven and all of their interest in Scottish songs, and this is the Scottish play, so there was a nice symmetry there. But beyond that, I just think that there's something so simple and so heartbreaking about both the music and the text of that song. And it's the only piece of text in the whole play that isn't from Shakespeare. And I loved that it was, there was a feeling of obliqueness to the experience and the words that it was referencing, but at the same time, it was such an expression of longing and of loss, really yearning for something. And we workshopped it and thought that it was the best way that we could express the kind of the absolute desolation, but at once the almost a moment in the show where Lady Macbeth is truly herself, or she is able to carve out some little space to just be and be absolutely honest in this moment. So it worked for us, and we hope that it worked for the audience.
There's something so disarming about hearing someone sing like unmiked that you're close enough to just be within their circle that matches so much with this concept of the show being kind of inside the mind, or you know, the humanity of this character. Yeah. That she doesn't have to be speaking out loud or you know, broadcasting in order to be present. And I can't imagine anyone in that room wasn't completely moved by that moment.
There was a lovely symmetry. Well, I felt like it also sort of spoke to the way that we're often told to play as well. There's like that link to that musical side where I'm sure, you know, that as string players in particular, you're so often told the highest point that you can reach is if you mimic the human voice. And so there was something, actually like just very moving for me. I mean, I'm absolutely not a singer, and so it's like very unvarnished in a way, but it was almost as if I was able to just like be very honest in that moment for myself as well, just to sing as I am able to, and that was enough.
Well, also hearkening back to what you were saying, Bridge, about you know, just like what can you do with a piano trio physically on stage? You know, I think a lot of the show was looking for sort of every different way in which we could take things outside the box or have kind of, you know, continual surprises for the audience, and so that it's not just a format of, you know, text play, et cetera.
So let's think, transition now into our final clip with that in mind, you know, that there's no formula here. It's not like an alternation between Brahms, text, contemporary piece, but that you've really quilted something together according to the dramatic arc that you've built. So this last section that we're about to hear incorporates several different elements. Julia, do you want to lead us through?
Sure. So of course this lullaby was in a way the turning point in this narrative. You had just now experienced the full Brahms trio and the fourth and the first movements in particular are so hot-blooded and thick-blooded in a way. And then suddenly you're going into this lullaby, and we're about to listen to this last clip, which is four different short pieces in a row. And actually, each of these pieces are related to what you've heard earlier. So the first that we're going to hear is Schumann's fifth canon, fifth canonic etude, going into Staud's ninth and tenth miniatures. And actually, in these miniatures, this is perhaps the most involved that Caroline has been in terms of actual dance and choreography. And this was something that we spoke about with her as well, in terms of how do we make a show with a dancer that that in turn highlights both what each medium is about without distracting or taking away from the other. And so it was definitely a decision not to have so much dance per se in the earlier movements, but in this ninth and 10th miniature in particular, Caroline, Lady Macbeth, is completely going crazy. And actually in the final rendition of this, or I think in our Boston performance of this, Caroline takes the liberty of committing that act of killing herself, which we read about in this play. And then, of course, after that, that intense drama, we're taken back, perhaps unexpectedly, to the very opening of the show, when you heard the Une Macchia, Equi Tuttora, which is a spot remains, a stain remains. And this was actually our very first arrangement as a trio. And Lee arranged it for the three of us. And so you're again being taken to this glorious singing, and it's in the mind, it's in the memory, and you're not exactly sure what's real at any point anymore.
And well, that's a version of insanity, right? Being unsure. Let's watch this. That's a beautiful description. Let's watch the last section here.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for sharing this show with us. That was nearly the whole thing, and hopefully that will entice you to see the Merz Trio play it live one day in a city near you in the near future, we hope. How has this project, you know, evolved? You've been mentioning that there was the Kosciusko Foundation performance and a performance in Boston, I think one in Vermont, if that's right. And did you have any future performances planned, or any plans to develop the piece further at this point? Julia, you're really nodding.
We do have another performance of this scheduled. It's this spring, this coming spring in New York City. Fingers crossed that this happens. It's
sure.
Of Andrew Ousley's Angel Share sessions, his crypt sessions, but it's in a new space called The Cave. And it's going to be part of a festival of different performances that he's putting on. And for this particular rendition, we are planning to hire a director and explore different ways that the three of us can be even more involved in the movement and in the interaction with Caroline, with the music, with the text.
It's really exciting to see where that goes. And are there any other projects coming up?
Yeah, so actually one thing we've been thinking about a lot in this time is our first album, which we're recording in October at Octavin Audio, where many wonderful people go record with the wonderful Ryan Straber. Actually it's been great to kind of be, just to have all this time to think about it in this time and be going over it in our heads. And something that we think about in general, not just when we're doing something overly theatrical like this, but for a lot of our performances is, you know, what's the story that we're telling? How do we bring these works in conversation with each other? How are we using music and text? All of these questions, they happen formally in some shows, very informally in others. For this album, it will actually feature all of our voices. We'll feature some readings and speaking, and we're kind of in and around the world of Ravel Trio. But Ravel Trio recontextualized through Paris 1914 when it's being written, and some of the things that you might have heard there, and also telling a sort of different story from the usual of maybe what are the important things going on in music in 1914. And so featuring a lot of our arrangements for that as well.
That sounds very exciting. I'm sure we will all be staying tuned to find out more about that album when it comes out. We will post in the description, you know, links that you can follow up with Merz Trio and check out some of their other videos and their website. But I have one last question for all of you. Favorite Avaloch memories?
I mean, that's like asking what's your favorite book, but I feel like it is a hard decision between sitting on the veranda in those blissful rocking chairs, which just make you feel like, I don't know. It always makes me feel like I'm in some sort of 19th century novella where nothing terribly bad is going to happen, maybe. but also dinner time, because of the food, obviously, but also because of the conversation. I love the way that you can just arrive at dinner and plonk yourself down at a table next to someone you've never met, and then you end up having a really, really interesting conversation that changes the way you think about what you do.
Definitely. I just loved all the performances at Avaloch so much. Every time I was there, it's just such a wonderful space for sharing and, yeah, meeting people like Bridge was saying and having those conversations.
How about you, Julia?
I agree with Bridge. There are too many good things to mention. We were lucky to go twice as a trio to Avaloch, and on the very final day of the first time, I somehow didn't realize that there was this lake, this pond, just in the woods down the street. And I discovered it, I think, along with you guys. And my mind was blown, and I felt like we had to go back. And so the next time I took a number of boat rides, and that was just, it's just such a wonderful place to reflect between your rehearsals and just be surrounded by gorgeous nature, which of course.
Well, we hope we can have you back again and many times in the future. Thank you so much, all three of you, for joining us tonight and for sharing this show with us. And we look forward to following all your exciting projects in the future.
Thanks so much for having us.
Thanks.